Tonight on Beyond the District, we see how drones may be helping your local fire companies.
Beyond the District will return in 2 minutes.
How far would you go to help someone? Would you go to the end of your driveway? Would you cross a street? Would you cross an ocean? Would you go if you could use your knowledge to teach someone? And in the process, maybe learn something yourself. Life is calling. How far will you go? Peace Corps.
You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will be as one.
Hello, I'm Nicole Coco, and welcome to TV21's Beyond the District.
And I'm Michael Boldo. Later on tonight, we will take a look at one Marine is getting a helped hand after being wounded in action.
But up first tonight, it looks like one for the record books at Western Michigan University. Over 1,000 couples helped set a world record for the most vow renewals made in one place at the same time. Brittany Gray has the story.
That you are married again under the eyes of the law.
One by one, hundreds of couples gathered here on Western Michigan University's East Campus. Each couple celebrating a different number of years of wedded bliss.
We're married 25 years, June 6th. They're married 1 year.
But all sharing one goal, to break the Guinness World Record for the most vow renewals made in one place at the same time.
We thought it was really cool to do it with our parents.
The event brought people from around the state, the country, and at least one case from around the world.
It was a great day to have so many Broncos together at one time to celebrate their love, celebrate their connection to Western, and be together.
WMU alumnus Bobby Hopewell officiated the renewals, and all at once they said, I do.
When Mayor Hopewell actually read and we had to repeat the vows, it was an emotional moment for me. I ended up getting tears in my eyes. It was just great to be able to do that again. I think it's something that maybe we should do every single year.
Miami University in Oxford, Ohio held the record with 1,087 couples. It was set in June of 2009. Records, of course, are meant to be broken. You won't see it quite yet in the Guinness World Records, but it looks like WMU beat that. Their count today, 1,201 couples.
Up next, pumpkins were on porches and yards, but not like the ones for the world champion layoff. Farmers are in Half Moon Bay, just south of San Francisco, to show off some absolutely huge pumpkins. Matt Keller reports.
It's fall in Half Moon Bay with foggy conditions and cool temperatures.
It's a sunshine thing.
But everything is a little brighter on the day of the world championship pumpkin weigh-off. Big pumpkins bring big dreams of the big grand prize.
It's the biggest thing I've ever grown. and I'm really excited to be here. This is my ultimate pumpkin fantasy, to be at Half Moon Bay with something really large.
Top contenders arrived early. The winner gets $6 a pound, which ends up being around $12,000 for a 2,000-pound gourd. But organizers started small on the scales.
All right, 47 pounds. Oh ho, 90 pounds. Good job.
You can spot the Passmore sisters by their pumpkin hats.
Mine is the one, the farthest one.
This is their sixth year at the weigh-off. They've never won, but it's still a competition.
First has been the biggest for a couple years now.
Now, do you expect to have the biggest in the future?
Hopefully.
And just like the top growers, there's a secret ingredient to their garden in the backyard of their Los Altos home.
Well, we have bunnies, and so we use their, like, poop as like fertilizer, and we put it in the soil, and I think that helps.
If you didn't get a chance to see the giant pumpkins today, you could still see the top four finishers at the Half Moon Bay Pumpkin Festival this weekend, Saturday and Sunday, here in Half Moon Bay. In Half Moon Bay, Matt Keller, ABC 7 News.
Now, stress doesn't just affect adults. Changes in your child's behavior could be a sign they are feeling pressure too. In today's Health Minute, Melissa Ranney has tips on what to look for.
Stress can affect anyone who feels overwhelmed, including kids. Here are a few signs for parents to look out for. Negative changes in behavior. For younger kids, withdraw from their favorite activities, becoming clingy to a parent, or even a sudden change in their appetite are all red flags. Becoming hostile towards family and abandoning friendships are more common signs among teens. Interaction with others. How your child interacts with others outside of the home can indicate if stress is a factor. Experts say a good way for parents to tap into their child's behaviors is communicating with each other, teachers, and coaches. Listen to your child. Kids may often express how overwhelmed they are with words like angry or annoyed, or speak negatively about themselves. Parents should keep an ear out for keywords or phrases that may indicate a source of stress. Seek support. Parents should know that tackling the stress in their child's life is not something they have to do alone. Licensed therapists can provide the support and guidance their child needs. For today's Health Minute, I'm Melissa Rainey.
Next, a young athlete showed what sportsmanship really means at a cross-country meet in Iowa. John Campbell has the story.
For those of you that were not there last night, you missed something pretty spectacular.
I just felt like it was probably more important for Adam to finish the race than me.
Those moments in sports and in life when, you know, you sort of realize that that's what it's all about.
Last Thursday, 916 runners took part in the MVC Cross Country Super Meet at Norridge Park in Cedar Rapids. But this is not a story about the winners. But then again, actually, it is. This is a story about two runners in the boys' JV race. Evan Hansen is a sophomore from Iowa City City High. Adam Todd is a junior at Cedar Rapids, Washington. He competes despite suffering from epilepsy and associated autism. This is a story about this picture. Two runners from competing schools hand in hand. You see, Adam Todd is fascinated with the ambulances, and he veered off course to check one out. That's when Evan Hansen came to the rescue.
Eventually, he again got lost off course, and I decided to just grab his hand and finish the race with him.
For a mile and a half, Team Hansen and Todd pushed on.
I was mostly just saying stuff like, "Let's go, Adam. We can do it. Not much left. We're almost there."
As they approached the finish line, other members of the City High team ran along, encouraging Adam.
It was pretty amazing, actually. I kind of pushed him in front of me when he finished. Wanted him to be in front of me because he finished it by himself, I'd like to say.
I can't tell you the immense pride that I felt, and the same thing with talking with Coach Hart from Cedar Rapids Wash. We were both pretty much choked up about that because, you know, you coach 20, 30 years, and it's moments like that that make it all worth it.
For someone to be aware of other people during a race when they're competing and trying to do their best just says so much about that person.
And there were people around me who were crying, it was just one of those magical moments, and you could see by the smile on Adam's face that things were going to be all right.
Very proud of you and glad you're on our team, big guy.
As we said at the top, this was not going to be a story about who crossed the finish line first, but it most definitely is a story about winners. John Campbell, KCRG TV 9 Sports.
Now we are going to take a short break, but coming up, we take a look at one high school football player who made history.
And we also take a look at a boy who is getting his chance to live out his dream. Beyond the District, we'll be right back.
I drive on the streets 'cause she's my companion. I walk through the hills 'cause she knows who I am.
Do you have ID?
Yep.
Oh, okay, thanks.
Welcome back. A Mississippi high school football player made history this past season. Kendall Breland became the first female in state history to ever score a touchdown. Taylor Currit reports.
Laurel High School won its fifth game in a row Friday night, beating Wingfield 61-14. But what occurred in the first quarter proved to be the play of the game. Up 7-0, Laurel senior Kendall Breland carried the ball into the end zone from a yard out, marking what is believed to be the first varsity touchdown by a female in Mississippi history.
I feel awesome. I've been trying to make history ever since I first came down here 3 years ago, even though I've been playing for 9.
And Kendall's natural position is at defensive tackle for the Golden Tornadoes, as she recorded one stop last season. But once her number was called Friday, it was all about just executing the play Coach Todd Breland drew up.
Dive right. I was supposed to go right behind the biggest lineman. I was scared out of my mind.
In the history of Mississippi high school football, female players have kicked field goals and extra points, but before Friday night, the MHSAA has never been notified of a female scoring a touchdown. Surely even Kendall couldn't fully grasp the scope of that one play as her teammates swarmed her in the end zone.
They were so happy they jumped all over me. One of them picked me up in the end zone, scared me.
Up next, a dream come true for a little boy living with terminal cancer. He loves firefighters, and as Rondella Richardson shows us, firefighters in Chelsea, Massachusetts made him one of their own for the day.
8 years old and outfitted with a uniform, this is a special call to duty.
It's really shocking just to see a firefighter car just in the front of my house, like, what?
Riley Sostre has been rushed from home before when he has massive seizures and stops breathing. He has chemo often because he has terminal brainstem cancer. Today, a good adrenaline rush and emergency ride.
Hey guys, this is Riley.
Meet the first third grader to be sworn in as a Chelsea firefighter.
I,
Riley,
do solemnly swear.
I can't imagine what he and his family are going through. It's, really puts things in perspective for you.
Hold back. There you go.
Oh, the joy of this. The oldest of four siblings, Riley wishes he could hose down his sisters.
I want to come there with them and just spray them.
At the surprise pizza party, Riley compared the rigors of working the hose to his regular day.
I play video games. My hands get tired.
You play Madden NFL football.
Toys on the engine worthy of taking home.
Maybe if you're nice, the chief will give you one. I don't know. You could ask him.
I'm a very nice boy.
There you go.
Riley's family so appreciate it today. They worry about his every tomorrow.
We notice the color of the sky. We notice the people walking by. So we're treasuring every memory with him.
You're like part of my family now. This is more friends than I ever had.
Now it took a year, but a Texas woman finally got her wedding ring back. It's all thanks to the honesty of a few department store workers. Kathleen Siri has the story.
Everything happens for a reason.
That's what Sonia James Stewart says about losing her wedding ring in the Coppers Cove Bell's department store 1 year ago.
Probably about 5 minutes being in the store, I noticed that I had lost my ring.
Right away, she told assistant manager Ellie Magruder.
We looked everywhere.
But still no ring until the next morning when Karen Tanner was cleaning the store.
I was just vacuuming and I bent down and I saw something real shiny like up under there, so I just bent down and I picked it up.
That's when she brought the ring to Magruder and she knew exactly who it belonged to.
Miss Karen found the ring. She just happened to go to the one person, Miss Ellie, that I had told I had lost the ring.
But Magruder hadn't gotten the ring owner's last name or phone number, and James Stewart says she was convinced she had lost it during a trip to Austin earlier that day.
I know she will be in someday. And believe me, every day I thought about it, I said, maybe today she's coming in.
And this Monday, James Stewart and Magruder finally crossed paths.
I couldn't control my words. I couldn't control the tears, and all I wanted to do was hug her.
She was just flabbergasted.
James Stewart says she can't believe her original ring is back, all thanks to a few honest employees.
I don't know if I could ever repay them for what they did, but I am so grateful.
In Coppers Cove, Kathleen Siri, KWTX News 10.
It is now time for another break. Coming up later in the show, we will take a look at one teen who is an internet sensation.
Beyond the District, we'll be right back.
I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words or ancient melodies.
For outcasts and rebels, or anyone who just dares to be different. And you've been trying for so long to find out where your place is, but in their narrow minds, there's no room for anyone who dares to do something different. Oh, but listen for a minute. Trust the one who's been where you are, wishing all it was sticks and stones. Those words cut deep, but they don't mean you're all alone. And you're not invisible here.
Welcome back to Beyond the District. I'm Nicole Coco. A Florida teen made a catch that's catching fire online. CNN's Janae Moose reports on the bobble of the year.
There are more unusual things to catch than a football. For instance, when a crowd-walking member of a Dutch band caught and drank a beer. Or when a dad sat his son on the luggage counter at an airport in Poland, the boy fell but was caught by a security officer.
There is the baby where he should not be. The baby falls. The father's putting on a coat. There it is.
At least 13-year-old Jaden Wilson didn't bobble a baby. The Youth Football League Pro Titans in Wellington, Florida, tried a little razzle-dazzle, then passed to Jaden. Watch him bobble behind his back, on his knees, on his feet. Bobbles again. Touchdown! An unforgettable catch, right?
I don't really remember the play. It was just shocking that I actually caught it when I ended up with it.
Jaden's dad was on the sidelines talking to his wife on the phone.
He kept bobbling the ball and I was like, he caught it, he dropped it. He didn't drop it.
How cool is this, at the age of 13, to not only be included in SportsCenter's top 10 plays, but to be number one?
Look at this play here. Bobbles it six times and makes the play.
Catch of the year, tweeted someone, but a naysayer disagreed. If he was actually really good, it wouldn't have been bobbled so much. Try telling that to the undefeated Pro Titans, not to mention Jaden's dad.
He averages about 2 to 3 touchdowns a game.
But this kid is humble. All that bobbling won't go to his head. Ginny Mo, CNN, New York.
Next, a tattoo artist in Alaska has found a unique way to help clients remember their lost loved ones. Reporter Eric Rubble introduces us to Miss Judy.
It's a regular day in the office for tattoo artist Miss Judy. That often means leaving her mark to help people deal with loss.
It's really nice to help them, that's for sure. It's very emotional. It's hard sometimes.
Each client has their own way to remember a loved one, but only a few make a special request, using that person's ashes as a part of the tattoo.
You're getting very, very, very tiny amount in there, but you are getting the ash. And that's what makes people happy.
It's beautiful. Amazing.
It's what Dana Durr decided to do after her 15-year-old daughter Jordan and her best friend Brooke were killed by a drunk driver.
She came from my body. I gave birth to her. I created her. And now that she's passed and her physical self is no longer with me, the ashes can signify her returning to my body.
The tattoo shows three flowers, one for each of her kids, and a black heart showing a mom and daughter.
Jordan's ashes are in the black silhouette of the mother and daughter, and since it's shaped like a heart, it just to me means our eternal love.
Dana says Jordan is always with her spiritually, but this was a way to keep her physically close.
The placement of it I put just so that if, and it could be symbolic, could be silly on my part, but I just liked it so that I could hold it to my heart.
It just opens up really.
Judy says she's an artist and a therapist for helping people grieve. Dana was no exception.
We all have to develop our coping strategies throughout life, and this is one that really helps me to feel good about keeping her memory.
Like her tattoo.
She is what I remember, not so much the tattoo.
Dana's bond with Judy is permanent. Eric Rubel.
Now we check out how drones are becoming popular aid in selling homes and fighting fires. But over the weekend, a drone led its way as hundreds of volunteers search for a missing 3-year-old boy in Wisconsin. And with the child now home safe, police and the drone company that aided in the search are talking about the benefits of working together. Daniel Keith reports.
High in the sky for a community in need.
The sheriff's department called us. And we headed out right away, first thing in the morning.
It was a very valuable resource.
As 400 volunteers gathered in Deerbrook in search of missing 3-year-old Dighton LaGalbo on Sunday, a tiny aircraft helped organize the search efforts.
We had all the ground search teams walk directly to the drone as means of walking in a straight line. Once they got to the drone, they'd spread out. We'd fly the drone to another spot.
Helped direct volunteers, helped with oversight of the entire field that we were looking on.
Cameron Berg said the boy may have been found much sooner, but the equipment he needed was at a testing facility in Montana.
We can send this drone up with a thermal cam.
Cameron says that unmanned aircraft like these right behind me could be the law enforcement tool of the future.
Drones are a lot more cost effective. in the long run, they're a lot more capable of doing these smaller jobs like this.
Langley County Sheriff Bill Greening agrees.
Department our size, there's no way we could afford a helicopter or an airplane for that matter, but these would be the next best option.
In fact, the sheriff's department already has a plan to go more high tech.
We've begun the process of looking at purchasing drones for our agency.
We would train their deputies on how to use drones. In the long run, I think that would be the smartest thing to do, so then they have them on hand whenever they need them.
Another helping hand, or eye in the sky, for local law enforcement.
Remember, if you have a story you'd like us to cover,
or if you have an announcement about an upcoming event, please send it to interschool mail to the TV studio at High School East, or you can email us at tv21@trschools.com. Also, be sure to tune in to TV21 throughout the day to catch this show and Thomas River Schools Today as we bring you stories around the district. Also, please take a look at our website, www.trschools.com/TV21.
Well, that wraps up tonight's show. For Beyond the District, I'm Nicole Coco.
And I'm Mike Boldo. Have a great night.
I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words.